Hi, everyone. Welcome to our memorial garden on a wet and rainy day. Hurricane Zeta is making its way through the southeastern United States, even as we speak, which means that today is a good old-fashioned rainy day. Rainy days, they have their limitations, don't they? They aren't very good for washing the car or going out on picnics. If you plan to propose to your husband out on the beach, a rainy day may not be the best background for that. We love a drive through the back roads to see the glory of autumn, but we usually like to do it on a crisp and sunny afternoon. Not so much on rainy days. But today is a rainy day, a bona fide rainy day, which reminds us that there are some things, some activities, some ways of spending time that are just right for rainy days, right? Curling up with a good book, dropping off to sleep after a few pages of said good book, taking a nice long afternoon nap. Are you noticing a theme here? Or what about sorting through the wardrobe of clothes that we really aren't gonna wear this winter, or maybe some that we are, but we think somebody else might enjoy more than we will? Or opening the oven door to see if the apple crisp is ready just yet. Taking walks can be fun on rainy days if you're bundled up and have dry feet. And one thing in particular that might be good for us to do on a rainy day is to get a cup of coffee or a cup of tea and think about the people in our lives whose stories have made our story possible. The people whose lives are threaded through the tapestry of who we are. The people we might look like or we might be as different from as night is from day. Get out a photo album if it helps, or thumb through your phone. Think about our saints, our cloud of witnesses. By the time you all see this little video clip, the sun might be out again. But even if it is, let's use this time of worship to recall our personal saints, and then do even more than that. Then to recall the saints of this congregation whom we've lost this year, whose lives are still fresh among us. And then to do even more than that, let's also take just a few moments to recall the families of those who this year have died as a result of the coronavirus. On the eve of this election, when so many choices are being made among men and women about who will be our leaders for the days to come. Let's take a breath. Let's take a moment and recall the ones who've led us already by their lives, and in some cases, by their deaths. Welcome to All Saints Day worship. Annette Jonk. Dick McQuay. Marie Rotz. Rich Lane. I'm going to read a list of names of those saints who've died this year from COVID-19.
They are, in their own way, heroes. They, along with all the others, deserve and need our prayers, along with their families. There will be one representative from each of our United States whose name I will read. Alabama, Jenny McDonald, 53, a special needs person who was the first to die in that state. From Alaska, Abraham Luke, 67, a Gwich'ya-Zee tribe member who lived subsistently. From Arkansas, Brian Dill, Sr., 59. From Arizona, Valentina Blackhorse, 28, mother of a one-year-old who worked for the Denishoto chapter of the Navajo Nation. From California, Mary Lou Armour, 43, who worked in law enforcement. From Colorado, Mike Larson, 56, chef and avid bicyclist. From Connecticut, Yasmin Pena, 18, a senior at Waterbury Arts Magnet School. From Delaware, Fred J. Clinton, 61, an inmate in the Sussex Correctional Institution. From the District of Columbia, George Valentine, 66, Deputy Attorney General for the District of Columbia. From Florida, Shannon Bennett, 39, Broward County Department Deputy. From Georgia, Ronald Stewart, 64, Sports and Business Management. From Hawaii, Art Whistler, 75, who was a botanist. From Idaho, Randall Osterhout, 64, died from a stroke related to COVID-19. From Illinois, Jesus Gutierrez, 80, little village grocer known as the neighborhood's abuelito, or grandfather. From Indiana, Joseph Katarski, 77, and his wife Kai Shin, 81, who died 1 week apart. From Iowa, Zachary Scott Overy, 35, father and home security and automation trainer. From Kansas, Dennis Wilson, 70, retired school superintendent, part-time magician, and grandfather of six. From Kentucky, Sharon J.K. Baker, 56, mother and MS patient. From Louisiana, April Dunn, 33, advocate for people with disabilities in the governor's office. From Maine, Leon Harriman, 71, nursing home resident in Belfast. From Maryland, Mary Wilson, 83, who was a senior zookeeper at the Maryland Zoo. From Massachusetts, Kennerly Nugent, 33, teacher and Generation Cambodian American. From Michigan, Bassi Afiang, 25, an engineering student. From Minnesota, Susan M. Jack, 69, a recent double lung transplant recipient. From Mississippi, Jerry A. Williamson and his wife, Frances J. Bond, of 50 years, both 72, died holding each other's hands. From Missouri, Jennifer Davis, 44, nurse at a senior living community. From Montana, Jim Tomlin, 77, retired high school teacher. From Nebraska, Derek Ramirez, 6, about to enter first grade. From Nevada, Jesus Garcia, 66, a line cook, died 2 days after his sister. From New Hampshire, Gene Randlett, 88, wheelchair-bound most of his life due to childhood polio. From New Jersey, Wallace Roney, 59, a jazz trumpeter. From New Mexico, Mario Pino, 67, Ira Pino, 65, Navajo teachers soon after the COVID death of their son, Marcus, 42. From New York, Isaac Graham, 67, longtime pastor of the Macedonia Baptist Church. From North Carolina, Virgil Sutton, 54, machinist who started Venture Church's addiction recovery ministry. From North Dakota, Roger Len, 93, believed to have declined a ventilator so it would be available to others. From Ohio, Stanley Morse, 88, trombonist and former church music director. From Oregon, Lynn Bryan, 70, the first to die in Oregon of COVID. From Oklahoma, Joe Diffie, 22, new father of 1 week. From Pennsylvania, Captain Doug Hickok, USA, 57, physician assistant. From Rhode Island, Ron Remillard, 72, and his son Dan, 43, who died 1 hour apart. From South Carolina, Demi Bamister, 28, a third grade teacher. From South Dakota, Bob Glanzer, 74, a state legislator. From Texas, Adolf Mendez, 44, an engineer. From Tennessee, Ron Golden, 56, truck driver. From Utah, Robert Graff, 77, a legislator. From Vermont, Robert Kirkbright, 90, retired fire chief. From Virginia, Brian Miller, 52, disability rights specialist. From Washington, Huang Din Nguyen, 72, Vietnamese boat people immigrant. From West Virginia, John Palmer, 85, one of three family members requiring a ventilator. From Wisconsin, Lawrence Riley, 66, United States Navy, retired. From Wyoming, Gloria, 73, and Larry Wheeler, 78, died 38 minutes apart, and their daughter, Dawn, 55, who died later that day. They were all members of the Northern Arapaho Nation. From Guam, Monsignor David Guitugua, 84. And from the U.S., Theodore Roosevelt, Charles R. Thacker, Jr., 41. These names are but representatives of the thousands, hundreds of thousands of people who've died of this terrible disease. Let's remember them and their families, even as we remember our own personal heroes on this All Saints Day.
Let's begin our time of prayer together today with a moment of silence. During this moment, you are free, of course, to pray however the Spirit moves you. But your special invitation today is to offer prayers around our upcoming election. Prayers for those who are running. Prayers for these times when the country is so divided. Prayers for peace at the polling places. Prayers for all the lives that are hanging in the balance. And prayers for ourselves that we might call upon our very best after the results of the election are in. Let us pray. O God, whose invitation to us is to know and to share love, whose call to us is to know and to share justice, we ask you just now to help prepare us for the moment at hand. This election is upon us, O God. And while we like to think of you as strong and mighty,
We also know that your power and strength are limited by the choices we make. And while we like to think that you are able to redeem whatever happens in our lives, that you can squeeze the good out of the worst of things, still we worry about how this election will go. We worry about the fate of our country as a whole, our democracy, our destiny, our place in the global community. And we worry about how the most vulnerable among us might be the most likely to be hurt by the unrest that could be instigated by whatever happens on Tuesday. Sometimes, O God, we learn about history. Other times, we are part of it. And this seems to be one of those times. And so if we are indeed at one of those times, O God, then help us all rise to the occasion. Help us all call upon our best selves, our bravest selves, our most compassionate selves. Inspired by the convictions you have given us, O God, help us to be the leaders you desire us to be in the days to come. May our participation in this election and our response to this election mark us as worthy to be among the cloud of witnesses that has shown us the way in the past, and among the disciples of Jesus who continues to show the way into the future. Help us call him to mind as we pray the prayer he gave us to say together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Good morning, and welcome to our virtual service video from Christian Temple. If weather permits, we'll also be celebrating a live stream service at 11 a.m. this morning, celebrating the saints of our church. You can access this live stream video via our Facebook website for Christian Temple. Our opening music will feature the hymn, For All the Saints. Our disciple hymnal uses the melody composed by the famous English composer, Ralph Vaughan Williams. The text was composed by William Howe, a bishop of the Church of England. He was known as the poor man's bishop because of his work with the destitute in the London slums. You'll be hearing the choir of First Plymouth Congregational Church from Lincoln, Nebraska. Enjoy and sing along. The text has been printed in the video. Our second piece of music will be the anthem, Saints Bound for Heaven, arranged by composer Alice Parker. Ms. Parker was a graduate of Smith College and is best known for her collaboration with Robert Shaw. She became his primary arranger for over 20 years and is one of the most famous women composers of our generation. The choir loves this arrangement. Enjoy. I chose Shall We Gather at the River for several reasons. Number one, Nora Roxy Dennehy sings the piece so beautifully. But an even more compelling reason was the fact that it was filmed during one of our communion services. And you'll get a much needed opportunity to see many of our beloved congregation coming forward for the bread and the wine. It warmed my heart this morning as I watched you greeting and smiling at each other as you walked forward. I hope it brings as much joy to your hearts as it did to mine. I'm looking forward to seeing some of you at 11 o'clock today as we celebrate our All Saints service on the upper parking lot. Dress warmly and maybe even bring a thermos of coffee. And you have my blessing to drink it during the service. I wish for everyone good health, and be sure and get out sometime this week and enjoy a walk in your neighborhood. The autumn colors are sensational this year. Have a blessed week. Thanks.
Good morning or good afternoon. Today's scripture reading is from Revelation 21, verse 1 through 6. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away tears from their eyes. There will be no death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." He who was seated on the throne said, "I am making everything new." Then he said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." He said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life." This ends today's scripture reading.
Will you pray with me? Loving and gracious God, it is our prayer just now that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts would be acceptable and pleasing to you. For you remain our rock, our strength, our hope, and our Redeemer. Amen. Lillian remembers that all around the house where she grew up, there were beautiful pieces of china and ceramics, pieces from all over the world. You see, Lillian's father was a journalist in the 50s and 60s mostly, and he would travel a lot following a story wherever the story took him. And everywhere he went, he would bring back a sample of the pottery and ceramics from where he'd just been. There were vases from China and teacups from Eastern Europe, candy dishes from the Middle East. Those pieces of glassware and pottery told the story of her father's life. Think about the walls and windowsills in your homes. The pottery, the knickknacks that are there, the stories that they tell. For Lillian, these pieces told the story of her father's life, but they also told the story of humanity in a way, because the lesson that her parents shared with Lillian, as she would quietly marvel at the beauty of each of those unique pieces, smelling the inside of a tea kettle from China to see where the aroma took her, running her index finger along the spout of the tea kettle or the rim of a tiny orange bud vase. The lesson she learned was that all people around the world were all uniquely beautiful. Lillian was never allowed to be afraid of people who were different than she was, because she was always able to see these people through the beautiful things that they made with their hands. That pottery in China spoke to Lillian about the beauty of humanity, and whenever the people of one country or another were featured in the news as associated with violence or war or civil unrest, or even terrorism, she would remember the pottery in her parents' home and know that there was always more to the story. Always. A president can try all he wants to villainize a country like China or people, maybe from the Middle East, Iran perhaps, but Lillian always had proof on the shelves of the home where she grew up, that there is more to the story.
more humanity, more beauty. Today is All Saints Sunday. It's a day to remember the official saints of the church: Francis, Augustine, Teresa. It's also a time to remember those who've lost their lives too soon for proclaiming what they believed to be the truth, causes larger than themselves, for saying what they were sure God was calling them to say. Martin and Ruth, with an intentional international podium, or maybe George Floyd and Jamal Khashoggi, speaking their truth by virtue of tragic circumstance. This is the day for the saints of the world, but of course this is also the day for us to remember the beautiful people who have been scattered throughout our lives, the pieces of pottery that decorate the household of our hearts, right? Most of those people, most of the names that get read at All Saints Sunday worship are people who are really quite ordinary. People who got up and went to work every day without saying much. People who joined us around the supper table one night and then the next and then the next. People who sang to us when we went to bed. Most of the people who were mentioned at the beginning of this service and who still fill our memories are people who are beautiful to us now precisely because they were so ordinary to us then. Some of us believe that we all have a human nature and a divine nature, and that somehow we are closer to God when we're able to rise above our human nature. But what about this? I wonder if the message of Jesus of Nazareth is that our humanity is what makes us divine, is what makes us special. And the more human we are, the closer we are to God. A few years back, I was in the gymnasium of Catonsville Middle School. It was the night when all the local middle school orchestras in Catonsville were playing together. The 6th, 7th, and 8th graders got together to play as one big ensemble for an audience of excited, expectant 5th graders about to be in middle school. Here's what it's going to be like. Now, I'm not sure what the song was. My memory doesn't take me there, that the orchestra was playing. Maybe it was the theme to the Titanic. Da 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 da. Or it might have been the theme to High School Musical, or maybe Climb Every Mountain. I'm just not sure, but I am sure that the combined orchestra was sounding so very human. It was one of those nights when parents could be spotted throughout the crowd, leafing through the program to see how many songs were left until it was over. But in the middle of that orchestra was this one young woman who was playing her violin, playing her heart out. I could see her. She was perfectly framed. You know how in middle school auditoriums or gymnasiums you got people on either. She was perfectly framed by the people in front of me on either side. And she was so absorbed in the music that was on the stand in front of her. She was just peering at that music. She was absolutely unaware of anything that was going on around her. Now, I couldn't pick her particular sound from the rest of the din ensemble, I mean. But at that moment, she became one of those beautiful pieces of pottery, so human that she was also divine. A crystalline moment of memory. Now, the scripture that Brooke read for us today speaks of pain and suffering and tears, being transformed by the God of Jesus Christ. I can count so many times when these words have offered comfort to people who've endured that kind of pain and suffering and loss, and their loved ones who are so fragile and vulnerable. The thought of them being in a place where that was no more is just so healing. But another way to look at these words from the book of Revelation is to have them tell us that there is, in our most human moments, moments of pain and tears and even suffering, the seeds of redemption right now. Sharing those kind of moments when we are fragile with the people we love, hard as those moments can be and are, they're the very thing that make life so deep and rich. Going through grief is so awful. Going through grief surrounded and supported by the ones we love deepens our lives, deepens our relationships, deepens our story. The new heaven and the new earth is something we can know right now for having been broken together, for having been human together, for having been pieced back together. There was this one vase up on the mantel in Lillian's home that she noticed as a teenager didn't fit with all the rest. And she wondered about it. It had once obviously been a fine antique with a cream glaze and blue, maybe an Asian, maybe from Japan. But now it was damaged, and it stood in the middle of the finer pieces, a mass of cracks, crudely pieced and glued together with adhesive that had yellowed over time. Everywhere the pieces met one another, glue bubbled out of the cracks like a scar. "Why didn't you get rid of that one?" Lillian asked her mother. "Oh, never," she replied. "It's the most valuable piece of pottery we have in the house." Then her mother told her its story. When Lillian was just a toddler, her father was covering the Vietnam War, moving in and out of war zones, out of touch from his family for weeks at a time. So when he returned home, it was a great homecoming, and he brought this piece of Asian pottery to add to her mother's collection. The vase was one of the finest he'd ever been able to pick out, and he'd wrapped it in brown paper and tied it with a string, then carried it carefully on several different airplanes from one airport to the next, before finally arriving at his home and grabbing the bag and walking up his driveway with this special gift in his hands. Well, at that moment, Lillian, his 2-year-old daughter, was so excited to see her daddy that she rushed forward with her arms outstretched for an embrace. Surprised and elated, she was too quick. Her father couldn't push her aside, couldn't stop her rush to put down the vase, and instead he simply opened his arms in response to her, and as Lillian fell into her daddy's arms, the vase fell out, and inside the brown paper bag broke into pieces. His arms flew out. That night, her mother broke out the glue and clumsily repaired that vase, and after she had finished, she pronounced that vase precious. People of God, hear the good news. The God revealed to us in Jesus of Nazareth, very human, is the God of the broken vase, the God who runs to us with exuberance to receive our love, the God who stretches out his arms spontaneously to offer that love, the God who carefully, tenderly, with the work of her hands, lovingly glues the pieces back together. Today, let us offer our praise and thanksgiving to this God and to the saints this God has been so kind to share with us. Amen.
Jesus, you're so free, and the Lord is to believe. Good morning. I'm Cindy Wagner, an elder here at Christian Temple, and I'll be leading us in communion this morning. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread, blessed it, broke it, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup and said, "This is the new covenant in my blood. Do this each time you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat of this bread and drink of this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." Let us pray. Gracious and sustaining God, we come to this table today apart from each other, but together in our gratitude for this special meal. As we join in communion today, we remember the saints in our congregation whom we lost this year and who often shared the bread and the cup with us. We give many thanks for their lives. As Jesus asked his followers to eat the bread and drink the cup in remembrance of him, we also do that today. May this meal be a blessing that strengthens us spiritually, gives us hope for the future, and sustains us as we live our lives with faith, compassion, and caring for others. Amen. This is the bread of life and the cup of salvation. May the peace of Christ be with you today and always.
Good morning. Today's benediction is titled, "God of the Living, a Blessing," written by Karen Armstrong. When the wall between the worlds is too firm, too close, when it seems all solidity and sharp edges, when every morning you wake as if flattened against it, its forbidding presence fairly pressing the breath from you all over again, may you be given a glimpse of how weak the wall and how strong what stirs on the other side, breathing with you and blessing you still, forever bound to you but freeing you into this living, into this world so much wider than you ever knew. Go in peace.